I know you smoke, I know you drink that brew. I just can't abide a sinner.
Good morning,
like you,
Austin,
you know.
And welcome to the Aces Experience.
Either.
We're
That's
coming at you live November 21st, 1999.
Jesus loves
we have your host, the
can't
Jeff
stand
D.
Here.
Delightful, D. Wonderful, D. Knighted Jeff D. We also have our co-host, Arlo Pignotti, our
died,
only ordained minister of the group.
Crossed every T and
we
I've
also have for today's guest, he might be last on our mailing list, but first in our
God's
hearts, Joe Zemecki. And here we go. Wake up, you heathens. It's time for the Aces Experience.
Whoa. That was awesome, Ray.
Thank you.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to the Aces Experience. I am, as Ray said, Jeff D. I'm playing host today while Ray takes a turn behind the camera, like as a refresher. Boy, we've already done that. We are live November 21, 1999. And before we get into the fun part of the show, let's start with our announcements. The Atheist Community of Austin has weekly meetings at the Hot Jumbo Bagel Shop near the corner of 5th and Lavaca. Here in Austin, we meet from 10:30 a.m. till whenever everybody gets tired and goes home, usually around noon. The first Sunday of the month is our lecture series, which takes place instead of the Bagel Shop meeting. Our next guest lecturer will be physicist Mark Lowy, and that lecture will be taking place at the Furs Cafeteria at North Cross Mall December 4th at 11 a.m. We'd also like to remind our ACA members and friends of the Rapture Party coming up on December 18. You're all invited to come dressed the way you'd like to be when or if the Rapture comes. And you can get time and location information at the meeting or call our voicemail at 371-2911. So, good morning. How you guys doing?
I'm doing great.
Joe here, for those of you who don't remember or haven't been watching our show that long, Joe was the original co-host of the show, and I was, I'm just an interloper here. I came in and took Joe's place when he moved out to New Jersey to work with American Atheists.
And you're doing a fine job.
Well, thank you.
We thank you. Hey.
Before we move on to guests, normally I do a news spot, and I guess I'll do news anyway as host. It's all new and confusing for me. Classroom compromise offered for evolutionists, creationists. As some Christians and secular humanists battle over whether public schools should teach creationism or evolution, religious and civil liberties groups have proposed a middle path between imposing religion and removing it altogether. The coalition has endorsed a First Amendment guide to the use of the Bible in public schools, which could help end the protracted legal war between the rival factions. This has been all over the news, and it's an analysis of what you can legally do when talking about religion in schools. A lot of people have raised, I think, a very valid concern, which is that while it tells you what you could legally teach in school, it doesn't make the case that that it would be a good idea to do that. Let's move on. The Supreme Court will hear the Santa Fe, Texas school football prayer case. You may remember that I went to that protest with my wife and our friend Dennis, and now that that situation has gone back to the Supreme Court for a ruling, that's in Santa Fe, the school is allowing students to initiate prayers before their football games. We have a piece of tape. Can we play that tape?
No tape today.
No tape? It's not going to happen? All right. Well, anyway, there was a segment played on CNN that showed me and my wife and her friend at the protest, which was kind of cool. And maybe in a future week when we have that set up, we'll show that segment. If you blink, you'll miss us. The Supreme Court's last major school prayer ruling was announced in 1992. And barred clergy-led prayers, invocations, and benedictions at public school graduation ceremonies. Quote, the Constitution forbids the state to exact religious conformity from a student as the price of attending her own high school graduations, the court then said. The ruling was viewed by many as a strong reaffirmation of the court's 1962 decision banning organized, officially sponsored prayers at, from public schools. But in 1993, justices refused to review a federal appeals court ruling in a Texas case that allowed student-led prayers at graduation ceremonies. That appeals court ruling, binding law in Louisiana and Mississippi as well, conflicts with another federal court appeals, the federal appeals court's decision barring student-led graduation prayers in 9 western states. In the Galveston County case, the Santa Fe Independent School District's policy of allowing students to deliver any message or invocation over the public address system at football games and to lead prayers at graduation ceremonies was challenged in 1995 by 4 students and their parents. The school district is located in a Houston suburb. Today's brief order limited the November 15th, limited the Supreme Court's review to the prayers at football games issue. So we'll have to see how that works out. Now, you may remember that the House passed a thing. It's not a law, but just sort of a we think this would be an okay idea a few months ago, saying that they thought it would be just dandy for there to be the Ten Commandments in schools. And now we're getting cases across the country where school boards are using that as an excuse or as an inspiration to go ahead and post them Ten Commandments. A school board in Riverside County, California, has voted to defy a U.S. Supreme Court ban and post copies of the Ten Commandments in school offices. Val Verde Unified School District Board President Bob Givens described the Tuesday decision as an act of civil disobedience. Quote, "I don't recognize the Supreme Court's laws any more than I recognize city laws. It is the views of the majority of the people that counts," Givens said, forgetting, of course, that in our system, in this country, what happens is the views of the people are what determine what gets to be laws, limited by the Constitution. There's a similar case developing in Illinois. I also wanted to just briefly mention the Egypt Air crash investigation. I'm sure you've all been watching that in the news. Yes. Early leaks suggested that a backup crewman who prayed may have caused the plane to crash, and the Egyptian government and citizens reacted, screaming, "Oh no, that's prayer, and suicide is a sin in our religion, and so he couldn't possibly have done that." And now the lead investigator is publicly decrying advanced speculation. I think that what is being missed in all this is that, you know, Egyptians, Muslims also can be very religious and yet drive trucks full of explosives into buildings and kill a bunch of people. So it's clearly not a case that prayer is proof against doing something crazy. Certainly, until we know for sure, or as sure as we possibly can, what's going on, speculation is a bad idea. But to leap to the conclusion that if you prayed, you can't possibly have done anything wrong is just goofy.
Can I make a comment about that?
Yeah.
There's two ways to interpret that. Supposedly, he pointed the airplane towards the ground, put it on autopilot, and gave a prayer to God. There's two ways to interpret that if it was on purpose.
Uh-huh.
It was, okay, pray to God to take care of the souls of the people who are about to die, or perhaps it's a test to see if God can fly an airplane. And it just brings a whole new meaning to God as my co-pilot. It makes it kind of a sick twist on the thing. And,
well, the Muslim argument is that's a thing they say, like, all the time. You put the keys in the ignition of your car, mm-hmm. and you say that prayer. Mm-hmm. Which is, again, I think completely irrelevant, but that's the case they're making, right? Mm-hmm. Just because you do something habitually doesn't mean that if you did it, you can't possibly have then turned around and done something nuts.
Right.
So, I don't know.
Well, I think it's saddening, though, that the advanced information that was put out about this, I think they probably knew there was going to be a lot of assumptions made about it, and there were, and I think it probably would have been better and more sensitive of a thing to do to wait until I got the whole investigation done. You know, though, they would have, had he said a Christian prayer, I'm sure they would have sat on it maybe forever. But whatever the reason, there are lots of reasons why people pray in that situation, good and bad, and who knows, I guess they, you know, will eventually tell us the whole deal on that, but I was saddened, though, right after that happened. I was standing in line at a 7-Eleven, and I heard a large, wealthy, white man making a joke about it right after it happened with the man on the other side of the counter, just because he was Middle Eastern in appearance, and it was sad, and I wish they would be more sensitive. Anyway.
Yeah. Yeah. I wish people were both more sensitive and more level-headed about all this stuff. One last thing before we move on, I want to do another Rapture report, because I've been lax on these and I actually missed one. Just to recap, these are the end of the world predictions according to these two websites that I consult on the internet that chronicle all this stuff. They have the names of the people that made the predictions and links to their web pages where you can read where they announced the predictions and email addresses so you can write to the people making the predictions and give them your comments. So it's well researched, and these are the predictions that are just generically pending right now. End of the world according to some Seventh-day Adventist literature. End of the world just sometime during this year according to the Jehovah's Witnesses. Once again, apocalyptic battle followed by peace as per a vision of George Washington. According to this apocryphal tale, the apparition of a beautiful woman appeared before George, saying, quote, "Son of the Republic, look and learn," unquote. Thereupon, he saw the world as it would be in 1999. Black clouds with red lights in the center, representing invading armies, spewed forth from all around the world and poured into America. After a massive battle, an angel sprinkles water on the world and peace is restored, according to this prediction. The height of the Antichrist's power when a terrible Holocaust will occur, as foreseen by astrologer Gene Dixon. In The Call to Glory, Dixon wrote, "As the Russian armies begin to move on the Middle East about 1999, Russian MIRVs and FOBs will rain down a nuclear holocaust upon our coastal cities, both east and west." Dixon also claimed the Antichrist was born February 5th, 1962. Could actress Jennifer Jason Leigh be the Antichrist? That happens to be her birthday. A pole shift will cause natural disasters and World War III, or so the sleeping prophet Edgar Cayce claimed. The end of the world, according to linguist/credophile Charles Berlitz, as predicted in his book Doomsday 1999 AD. Any of a number of scenarios could happen, claimed Berlitz, including nuclear devastation, asteroid impact, pole shift, or other Earth changes. That's just the generic ones that are supposed to happen sometime in 1999. Sometime in November, yeah?
Oh, I just wanted to add an Antichrist to that list, because on TV late at night,
yeah,
there's a Christian group in Austin, and on cable access, they were claiming that Gorbachev is the Antichrist, because he has a mark on the forehead.
And he's supposed to do something in 1999?
Well, because he's done so many good things, that means he's the Antichrist.
Oh! Remember that again!
Yeah.
That's just amazing to me. That was the thing that struck me the most. We went and saw the movie... The Omega Code.
Ah.
A whole batch of us went out to see this
great
thing. And the thing that just really struck me, and I'd noticed it before, but it just the movie brought it home, was that anything nice that happens is determined as a sign of the impending apocalypse, because that just proves that the Antichrist is like, you know, working behind the scenes trying to make you like him. And anything bad that happens is a sign of the Antichrist, of the end of the world, because that's a sign that he's actually making the end of the world come about. It's just nuts. Sometime in November, we're supposed to, according to Kevin Brent Pryor, he predicts that Jesus will be born again in November 1999, possibly the 22nd of the month, which would be tomorrow, in the form of a baby girl called Uni in California. How did he arrive at this somewhat unorthodox conclusion? Well, you see, it's because Jesus' real birthday is July 4th. Yes, that July 4th. And also, Kevin was John the Baptist 2,000 years ago, he claims. Now, I missed one on the 7th. According to Richard Hoagland, that's the lunatic that's always talking about the face on Mars, despite the fact that that's been massively debunked, he still thinks that means something. If we needed any further proof that Hoagland has lost all remaining touch with reality, this is it. In between ramblings about Soho, Art Bell, and NASA, Richard tells us that something momentous was going to befall on November 7th, the date of the X-Files season opener. That, and of course, that didn't happen, and the the second part of the two-parter X-Files season opener was on the 11th, and that was also not the apocalypse. But now, here's the one that's coming up. On November 29, 1999, according to Dmitry Dudoman, according to a series of visions that he received, Babylon, i.e. the United States, will be destroyed in a nuclear conflagration, apparently about 3 years from November 29, 1996, which means November 29, 1999, and we'll all keep our eyes open for that one.
A lot of people are claiming the second coming of Jesus. Wasn't it just a few months ago there was that chimp that mysteriously got impregnated, yet the chimp was, it was a female chimp with only sterile male chimpanzees, so might that be interpreted to be a matter of perception? The second coming may be a chimpanzee, and I heard one person jokingly claim that they turned the water into banana pudding. Keep an eye out
we've
for
got
that.
Some callers on the line, but I'd like to get to Joe before we get into that. So, Joe, welcome back to the show, man.
It's great to be here.
How's things been going in Jersey?
Yeah, the people have been great. The people of New Jersey are just wonderful. They have really come across and helped us. I've met a lot of atheists in New Jersey. In fact, we deal with some companies, and once in a while I'd be working with like a print shop or something, and a guy will turn to me and pull me aside and say, you know, just between you and me, I'm an atheist too. I just don't let it get out, and that's happening in New Jersey quite a bit. And you know, they were really excited, the Christians were really excited about us moving there in the first place, and we haven't had any problems from them or anybody else. We're not going to start any big trouble there, lawsuit-wise, of course, but it's a very diverse community up where I live in Cranford, and I live in Elizabeth, the center's in Cranford, just down the street, basically, and yeah, it's very religiously diverse, and everybody's been real nice. They're very tolerant up there. I wanted to plug this real quick. This is the fall 99 issue of the American Atheist magazine, and it's about creationism in the schools. And I don't know if you can see, but the students have blinders on, and they're being taught only that creationism is good, evolution is evil, et cetera, et cetera. And Tom Sullivan is our artist here, a member. He's really good. And that had some good stuff in it. Talk later on, I guess, about that, but...
Okay. Did you know I lived in New Jersey for a while?
No, I didn't.
I went to art school there in Dover.
Dover, wow.
Yeah.
Wow, it's most of New Jersey is very nice. I want to say that. Yeah, there's some parts that are kind of difficult, but most of New Jersey is just beautiful, green, lush. Mary?
You want to go to Mary?
Yeah.
Mary? Didn't take.
Hello.
Mary's on one.
Mary's on one.
On the air, on one.
One's on.
One is supposed to be on.
You got two on, according to him.
Okay, Mary?
Hello? Mm-hmm. You just cut off
just
two.
Released.
I just released two.
Two, yeah.
Well, we don't get monitor at all.
We have a technical problem. And I accidentally hung up on Mark. So, Mark, please call back.
While we're waiting, can I went, oh, hello?
Try the phones again.
Hello?
Try the phones
again.
Okay, hello?
Hello.
Hi, Mary.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Hi, Mr. Zemecki.
Hello.
How do you like New Jersey?
Well,
we're not hearing, by the way, guys, we're not hearing the sound very well in here.
Can you make
it louder?
Sound up?
And I don't feel like talking wasted words.
New Jersey's great.
Can you still hear me?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, we got you now.
How do you like New Jersey compared to Texas?
Well, it's quite a bit different.
I'll bet.
We got there, in fact, on the first of the year, January 1, we drove in. It was about 6 inches of snow everywhere.
Ooh.
And I'd never driven on stuff like that. But like I said, the people were real nice. We were wondering if there was going to be some problems because of who we are and all.
Right.
But we really haven't had that problem. And
cool.
Met a lot of wonderful people. I live really close to Staten Island also, and I can drive to the Staten Island Ferry and take that into Manhattan, mm-hmm. going by the Statue of Liberty, and it's just beautiful.
Oh, what fun! Guys, so much fun. Oh, I'm so tired of being in Texas, I could die. I've had enough of Texas, I think. Looking for something different. It's so good to see you. You look wonderful.
Thanks. I had
to. I wish you'd come back more often.
Yeah, it'd probably be a while. This was an expensive trip.
It was. But it's just really good to see you.
All right.
Well, I called because I have a reason to call. I wanted to ask you, what was Jennifer Jason Leigh's birthday?
Jennifer Jason Leigh's birthday? According to this source, it's... February 5th, 1962.
That's my birthday. I'm the Antichrist.
You're the Antichrist.
Yeah.
There can be only one. All you Antichrists are going to have to go off and have a big battle. Sort it out.
And I was freaking out. But I got a comment to make about that guy saying that the majority rules, okay? And
yeah.
They want prayer. But you know, that's really a real misunderstanding of the Constitution.
That's right. He's talking about mob rule is what he's talking about.
Exactly. And the Constitution is very clear about they don't have the right to run over minority rights.
Right.
Okay? So that's kind of un-American. And I think I've said un-American on this show before. But if they want a king, what are they doing in America?
Yeah, monarchies simply don't work in today's day and age, I don't think.
And they're unwanted. Nobody's good enough to be a king. They're not the boss of me. None of them. Anyway, but that's just me, and I'll always be, at my core, an anarchist, all right? And someday it's going to be okay to be one, because we're basically anarchists are pussycats, all right? And that's what people don't understand. They think we throw bombs, and we're not bomb throwers. We just want to have a good Sunday morning with a nice buzz with Mr. Zemecki in town, and Arlo, and Jeff, and everybody else. And I'm going to go, but it sure is good to see you, Mr. Zemecki.
Thank you. It's Joe, by the way.
Thanks for being here.
Okay.
Bye.
See you.
Thanks for calling, Mary. Mary is one of our longtime watchers, and we've still never met her in person, but she has joined the group.
Ah.
Yeah, she has officially joined. Let's move on to, is that Mark again? Mark?
Yeah, hi Jeff.
Hey.
Hi Joe, Arlo.
Oh, hi Mark,
hey,
it's Mark Lowy.
Yeah, I wanted to point out that last Friday was the oddest day for the next 1,000 years.
It was the what?
The oddest. It was a very odd day.
How's that?
The 19th day of the 11th month of the year 1999, all digits in that date are odd. For those watchers who are interested in numerology, of
course.
And I wanted to point out that nothing happened.
Yeah.
Nothing odd happened.
Yeah.
The next odd day will be in the year 3111.
Really? Is it that unusual to have a date that's all odd numerals?
Well, there won't be any during the next millennium because
wow.
of the two.
Yeah. Interesting.
That's kind of like 9999 was not a problem.
Yeah.
Yeah, what about 9999? Oh, there was a 09, right?
That's right.
So a zero counts as a counts as an even number.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting.
And for those who are interested in making predictions regarding even days, I wanted to point out that the 2nd of February of next year will be the first totally even day in over 1,000 years.
Huh.
And
what date is that?
That's 2nd of February.
2000.
Okay.
Neat. Check it, all the digits are even. And what I'm curious about is why people place so much emphasis on the turn of our century, which is neither an even nor an odd day. Anyway, just a little fact I got a kick out of.
Cool. What are you going to be talking about on your lecture on the that is coming up on the 4th of December?
Well, I'll probably say some things about basic notions regarding predictions of science and give a couple of examples of how one builds a theory and what the meaning of an equation is and so on, some very simple examples, and point out some fallacies. If I have time, I might say some things about some interesting experiments that are done to test predictions of quantum mechanics.
Okay. Cool. All right, we're all looking forward to that.
All right, great.
Okay.
Joe, nice chatting with you.
Okay. You too. Thanks for calling.
Uh-huh.
Is Mark going to be on the show?
Mark, you still there? No, lost him. I don't know whether he'll be the guest that day or not.
Okay.
You guys want to take more calls?
That's Mike, not Mark.
Well,
Mike is on three. Mark was on two. Oh. That's who I was talking about.
Mike.
You guys want to take more calls, or?
Well,
I know we all got a lot of material here today.
Oh gosh.
I wanted to mention one.
Yeah, but there's no such thing as getting the calls out of the way. They
right,
keep calling.
That's right.
Let's take Mike.
Hello.
Mike.
Yeah, the person that left. Your left. Is his name Sean Bennett?
It's Joe.
No, not the other person.
Okay.
Sean Bandit. No, sorry.
Arlo.
Arlo Pignatti.
Oh.
Sorry.
Yo, yo, yo.
Yeah, okay. Thanks a lot. We'll go to Christina on 4. Christina?
Oh, hallelujah!
Praise God.
What can we do for you?
Praise the Lord and pass us off.
What'd you say?
Praise the Lord and pass us off.
Just the hallelujah hoedown today.
Yeah.
There is?
Atheist bash.
Oh, cool.
Where the lovely Joe is standing.
Do you have a question?
No, I have a comment.
Okay.
Do you guys have the next 6 years so I can tell you my story?
No, we don't have that long. Can you sum it up?
Okay. Well, I just want to say good morning for today.
Good morning.
And I thought ACA meant adult children of alcoholics in this community. I didn't know it meant atheist community of Austin.
Well, there may be another. Are you in that other group?
Yeah, I am.
You are. Okay.
Yeah, ACOA, ACA.
How's that working out for you?
Excuse me?
How's that working out for you?
It's working out great. I'm having a wonderful time.
Okay.
This community is a wonderful community. I've lived here 6 years.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a registered nurse in this community.
Uh-huh.
However, do you want me to share the painful stuff or just stick with the good stuff?
As long as you stay interesting, we're willing to keep talking.
I'm going to tell you the real stuff.
Okay.
Ever since I've moved here, I have gotten beaten 3 times in this town.
You've gotten what?
Physically beaten.
Beaten?
Yeah.
In this town?
Correct.
By the same person?
Nope. The last time was at a hearing on Tuesday night at the Longhorn Pipeline situation by 2 Austin Police Department. The SWAT team, I was told.
The SWAT team beat you up?
I heard there was a protest.
They strong-helded me, uh-huh. And I went to the Austin Police Department on Friday and reported them as internal affairs.
This is very interesting.
Yes.
But we kind of have a topic on this show.
What's the topic?
Well, we're atheists. You got questions about atheism?
Okay. I just want to tell you all that I've lived in this community for 6 years.
Uh-huh.
I'm a registered nurse in this community,
uh-huh.
And I am. I have done a lot of spiritual, emotional, physical, and mental healing in this community. And for me, Jesus is Lord. What? I am not in control.
What do you mean by spiritual healing?
Therapeutic touch?
Yeah, that too.
Ah.
I do massage in the United States. I've had a massage business for...
Yeah.
Whatever. Yes, therapeutic touch.
Yeah, I'm sorry to hear that.
What do you mean by Jesus is in control?
Well, step 1 and through step 12 of the 12-step programs tell me that that's what ACA is. It's a Alcoholics Anonymous 12-step program.
Yeah, they have programs for non-believers who have trouble with alcoholism.
Secular organizations.
Cool. Right, right. Well, that's true.
And
that's
rational
true.
Recovery.
Mm-hmm. You guys know Kirk Franklin's coming to town and C.C. Winan? You ever hear of them?
No.
Kirk Franklin, he was convicted or accused of being Christian music. He's a gospel singer, a black gospel singer. He's going to be at Frank Irwin Center on December.
He was convicted of doing Christian music?
In the secular world. In the
I didn't
secular
know that was
world.
Illegal.
What?
Yes, I'm telling you.
What are you saying? He was convicted of what?
He was accused of doing Christian music in the secular world. In other words, spreading the gospel throughout the world.
Where is that illegal?
Yeah.
Is what we're trying to figure out.
That's a good question. I don't know. You might look at Dallas.
So this guy is so cool because of something that happened to him that you don't even understand.
He went through a deliverance, I guess. People
okay.
say, talk about having a... he's like, he has a song, Do You Want a Revolution? Woo, 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 do you want a revolution? Woo, woo, I can sing it for you.
Thanks for calling.
Maybe we should... Have,
and enjoy your next 6 years in Austin.
Maybe we shouldn't have taken calls.
No,
that's really odd.
That reminds me, on Staten Island last week, I went to a creationist seminar at an evangelical church.
Uh-huh.
And it was a person who travels the country giving these seminars, and he was from Dallas. And one of the things he said, he was talking about Texas and how we don't know. He said, this is crazy. He said, in Dallas, they don't have any good Italian restaurants. He was trying to make an analogy of some kind with creationism, but he never even mentioned evolution. But then he goes and he sidetracks. He goes off the subject and he talked about ice hockey in Texas. And he said that, this is him saying, he said that people in Texas don't know anything about ice hockey, and he'd never heard of Gordie Howe from the Houston Aeros or the Austin Ice Bats. You know? So maybe he should learn a little more. But that's creationism, that's though. Like, I mean,
yeah, just making up accusations about stuff that you think your audience will also not like.
And before I moved here from Michigan about 12 years ago, but it was a minister, but I guess it doesn't matter, but they made the comment, what are you going to do without trees?
Huh?
They saw the movie Tremors and they thought,
they decided all of Texas has no trees?
Yeah, and someone made a comment that someone else was telling, what are you going to do without water? I have some right now, we're doing fine.
I also went to the Klan rally in Manhattan.
Right. Yeah, you called us with a report about that. That was deeply cool.
I didn't have much time to talk about them. I just want to say real quick, it was very interesting, like being in a U2 video from three different directions throughout that downtown area. You'd see parades of people marching towards the area we were at. And they had huge red flags, just solid red flags. And there was steam coming up out of the manholes, and it was cold and windy, just like a video. And it was inspiring, though. Thousands of cops, thousands of protesters, couldn't barely find a Klansman. There was 18 that showed up and 6,000 people to protest them, and it was just inspiring. Anyway, I just love talking, because in Manhattan you can see all kinds of weird things, and I'm trying to go down there whenever they have
something.
They
don't put up with that particular kind of nonsense there. Oh, and I just want to make a comment. Our last caller talked about therapeutic touch. For those of you at home that don't know what that is, that's these healers who claim that they can feel and manipulate your energy aura, and they can make you better by doing that. That's been completely debunked. There is no such thing as an energy aura. Anybody who tells you they can feel that is a liar. So don't give them any of your money. Shall we go on to another call? We got Amanda.
Hi, good morning.
Good morning.
One thing before we get going here, the last call you had,
she
must have been living last night's party.
I guess.
Yeah, she was on something because she kind of burned a few of my brain cells there. Let me ask you a question. What exactly is your point here? What are you trying to show me something? Are you trying to teach me something? Or what are you doing on my channel?
Just to show.
Well, it's a community channel, so I mean we share it too. Mainly, we're here as an outreach to atheists who are mostly isolated and alone and feel
something like AA. You're just reaching out now to people who don't believe.
Well,
Christ.
Except we're not trying to cure people of being atheists. That's fine with us.
No, just like I'm talking more like outreach, meaning you're trying to get all together, the togetherness thing.
Sure.
Good.
Secondarily, we'd like people to have an opportunity to talk to real atheists and hear what we really think about stuff.
What's the definition of an atheist? What's a real atheist?
Definition of an atheist?
Somebody who doesn't believe in any gods.
Any gods?
Yeah.
Okay, so that doesn't make you bad, right?
We don't think so. But there are an awful lot of people out there who will tell you that it does. So that's part of the reason why we're here, too.
Do you believe in anything?
Anything
at all? I mean, let's take God out of the picture.
Okay.
Do you believe anything at all?
Rational things.
Spiritual?
It depends what you mean by spiritual.
What do you mean? I'm asking you the question.
I don't use that word because it's got a lot of different meanings, some of which I think are valid.
Godly?
Well, obviously not godly, because what would that mean to me since I don't believe in any gods?
What word do you use then? If we don't use spiritual,
emotional, ethical, I talk about enjoyment. I talk about love. I mean, those are all real things to me. I don't know what people mean by spirituality. It seems like just a header to dump a bunch of stuff under so that you can believe in a lot of further supernatural things that I don't think are warranted.
Supernatural. Do you believe in devils?
No. Why
like
would we?
Evil. So if you, good. I like that. That's good. You're helping me here. See,
we're
I'm good. Learning something today.
We're immune from devils. Mm-hmm. Who else can say that?
Immune from devils. I am too.
Right.
But I believe in God. That's, I guess that's my my thing. Okay, good. Well, I hope you guys have a good holiday.
You too.
Take care.
It's a holiday? Wait a minute. What holiday is today?
No, the holiday's coming.
Oh, coming up.
Okay.
Just checking. Just checking. Sometimes you get past us.
Bye-bye.
All right, bye-bye. That was
Well, that was Amanda. Now we're on
that
two.
Was on one.
Okay.
We release one, and we're going to Mike.
Feedback two.
Mike?
Hey.
Hi, what can we do for you today?
Do you guys believe in the Bible?
Can you turn your TV down, please?
What was the question? The Bible? Do we believe in the Bible? Believe in it. I've seen one.
Yeah.
I have one.
Ooh, me too.
Do you believe God, Jesus died for your sins?
Not particularly.
I don't think
that I don't even know
sense.
What that means.
Yeah, we're getting feedback.
Yeah, can you talk louder?
And maybe we're turn your TV down.
Yeah. Oh.
Yeah, that's...
What's the guy's name with the long hair?
That's not good at all.
That's Joe.
I'm Joe. Much better.
I went to school with you.
We're having an awful lot of trouble hearing the caller.
I think he said he went to school with you, Joe.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Which school is that?
Remember that one time you were with that girl and...
Okay. Well, remember right. The name of the school, good. We're not going to believe
it. All right. Well, goodbye.
Extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence.
And... Thomas. Thomas?
Nope. That's four. Thomas?
Hello?
Yes.
Thomas, there you are.
Hey, good afternoon, brothers. How y'all doing?
Good.
Well, first off, I was just kind of surfing the TV and found you in there, man. I see three very intelligent, articulate human beings. And for a long time, I considered myself an atheist as well, but I'm not going to tell you I'm a spiritual person. I see where you're coming from with your thoughts on spirituality. But, man, what I get from y'all is just negativeness, man. It's okay not to believe in what a lot of people are trying to falsify in the name of God and brotherhood and humanity and all that stuff.
Uh-huh.
And I'm down with that. I agree with you on that. But man, I think, in my opinion, you guys might find some more positive outlooks to inspire brothers and sisters out there and show them that you can find good things to believe in, not spirituality, but conviction. I think you know where I'm going with this, but without pointing out, you have to be a member of a Bible watching or reading clan, you know what I'm saying?
Right. Well, you still have
to. So, you know, man, it's good that you're going to be down on all those people, but find me a couple people that you're up on who aren't doing that or aren't preaching God or the church or the Bible and doing positive things for us.
Okay, fair enough. I mean, we don't have a problem with any of those things. I mean, not needing a supernatural justification to go out and do, you know, community service or donate money to worthy causes or things like that. Not believing that there's a supernatural reason why we should do that doesn't stop us from going right ahead and being involved in all those things. We've marched in protests at several events.
AIDS march.
AIDS march.
Victims' rights.
Victims' rights. Mm-hmm. There was a bill they were trying to pass in the Texas legislature that would have denied the right of any family with homosexuals in it from adopting children, and that was wrong. We opposed that. Now, I suppose you're thinking this is all negative still. We also give blood, but that's, you know, we give blood because there are people that need blood, and then we're talking about injuries, and is that negative too? I don't know. I mean, addressing real problems, you can call that negative. Okay.
Yeah, that blood drive is good because that's something you can't buy with money.
Right.
And you don't have to have money in order to give it.
I donate money to worthy causes. I donate money to the Planetary Society, which does supports the space program in the United States.
Yeah, Sydney, that's what I want to hear from y'all right now, is what you're telling me now, not about protests and stuff like that, not a non-conflicting point, but a positive, inspire me, make me feel like, hey, man, this brother's doing something, he's got a positive thing, communicate that message of the groups that you do support.
Yeah, well,
and
see,
inform me that way, and then I could participate in that, because, man, I'm just the most neutral person. I won't participate in any conflict, whether I agree with either side.
Okay, go ahead.
I was just curious, what is it that we had done that you've seen in the show that made us negative?
Man, it's just most of the stuff that y'all do is it's more of a critiquing and a critical point of view, which, man, I agree with a lot of your criticism. I really do. But I think you might, to make it an interesting program, you might add a little more balance to it. There's some positive stuff out there. Just as this man just pointed out, that's exactly what I wanted to hear. Thank you for taking that.
Okay.
All right, have a nice day, guys.
Thanks for your call.
I see criticism positive if you're criticizing negative things.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and that's important too.
Yeah, somebody, I mean, if there are things that are being, ideas that are wrong, that are widely believed, are Things that people are doing that are wrong, that are widely practiced. I mean, somebody does at some point have to speak out about that. And if we think that that is a bigger deal, opposing that stuff is a bigger deal than, giving money to charity or some of these other causes, I mean, that's a judgment call we have to make. But sure, I mean, we don't want to give people the impression that we're all just about attacking stuff. We're about doing whatever we think is important, and we have to make a call about what we think that is.
Mm-hmm. And a lot of the issues we all talk about are kind of silent in the media, that you don't hear much about these issues sometimes other than an alternative show.
Yeah.
Most callers seem to call us old brothers, and that sounds positive, but I'm convinced we're all cousins. Is that positive enough?
I got all the lines lit up. Do we not have calls?
They're not ready. The Bagel, okay. Do you want to announce our meeting?
Yeah, I'll just remind everybody that we meet at the Hot Jumbo Bagel Shop near the corner of 5th and Lavaca at 10:30, right after the show. And that goes on till noon or whenever everybody gets tired and goes home. And that is for anybody who's an atheist or atheist friendly. It's not an opportunity for people to come down and preach at us, because you can do that here on our show. We got Bob. Bob?
Hey, Bob.
Bob?
Hey.
Hey, Bob.
You guys believe in some weird stuff. You guys are pretty stupid.
What's the weird stuff we believe in?
You guys are dumb.
Sorry, we're not smart enough for you.
You need to learn some more from us?
I think I've seen one of you guys in a porno before.
Okay. Thanks for calling. I don't know why we're getting all these all these crank callers today, because we
unusual.
Never do that. It's like solid. Whoa!
All right.
Now we got some calls.
Lisa? Lisa?
Hello?
Lisa? Lisa?
Nope. Okay.
I'm having trouble getting people on the air for some reason.
Oh, it's on. She's not on. No,
just... Okay, let's go to...
Let's release that and go to Dean.
Dean.
Yeah, where's the meeting at?
Hot Jumbo
Bagel. It doesn't matter where it is.
Good great. This is amazing.
Can I take this opportunity?
Sure, please.
I have a website I'd like to plug. It's for my new group, a local group in New Jersey called Union County Atheists. Very new and very small, but it's www.angelfire.com/NJ/atheists.
Cool.
That's it, yeah. And got a picture of me and my kids on my website, too. Anyway.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Shall we brave the phone lines once again? Or
I wanted to talk about
thing.
Creationism a bit, something I experienced this week. I'm very big on the evolution versus creationism debate. And what I learned from something last week, I learned that I've been giving way too much credit to creationists. I'm sorry if that sounds negative, but see, I always looked at creationists as people who, they do care about science somewhat, they're just not very good at it. But I take that back. I was invited to debate with some young Earth creationists, and it turned out there were some old Earth creationists that got to this guy first, and they were debating. And I got somewhat involved in the discussion, and it was sort of a three-way debate. And the old Earth creationists and young Earth creationists were both making their claims of the age of the Earth strictly on biblical scripture. They didn't bring up science at all, no physical science whatsoever. And this surprised me, because these are people that claim creation science is an actual science. And I jumped in, and I brought up a scientific question, and one of them stopped, the young Earth creationist stopped, and he looked at me, and he goes, "Are you Christian?" And I said, "Oh, no, I'm atheist." He goes, "Oh, I thought you were Christian." He turned around to the other guy, and he said, "Well, I'm talking to you." And they went on doing their Bible battle.
Went among themselves, against each other, right.
Right. Mm-hmm. And I wasn't compatible with the rules in their little role-playing universe, their little fantasy. And this person is on TV a lot. I don't know his name. He's part of Defense of the Faith. And he's on TV, and when he's on TV, he tries real hard to sound scientific. But apparently, when there's no non-believers around, there's only Christians around, it's pure theology, pure religion. And on his show, he denies it's religion, it's science. And because I unintentionally was a stealth atheist and got in on that discussion, I saw what happened there, and I was amazed. It's more
That's
religious than I thought.
Just what happened to me when I went to Staten Island and I saw that creationist seminar. It was no science. Mm-hmm. It was all Bible lessons. And it was all about the original Jewish interpretation and meaning. What was their original intent? That's what is the key to creationism. And he never mentioned science. And, you just kind of sit there and you're like waiting for this science talk, but There isn't any.
And he did get to me, and then he brought up science, but of course it was very lousy examples, I thought. And one thing you got to realize is when you take maybe 1% of the information out there, of all the information, might sound like it supports a young Earth theory, but to, and then they say, and if you say, well, perhaps that's just a puzzle, that, okay, that doesn't fit with old Earth, but that's a puzzle to be figured out, and they'll say, well, that's on faith that you think there's an explanation for it, how dare you, but yet they're taking the other 99%, oh, that's a puzzle, it's okay to take this 1%, so you see, you kind of flip-flop it there, and never looked at it that way before. Well, let's go back to the phones.
Tyler?
Hello?
Hello?
Yeah, what exactly is atheist?
Atheists are people that don't believe in any gods.
So y'all don't believe in a god?
Right.
So where do you think you're going to go when, after y'all leave this world?
Well, into the ground a bit.
So you don't think that there's like an afterlife or like...
No.
For real?
What?
So
really? For real? Yeah. There's no afterlife.
There is no afterlife, so this is like the only place that you're at, and when you die, you're just...
Nothing. Yep. Sure thing, don't waste your time while you're here believing dumb stuff.
Yeah.
It's okay. We go back into the Earth and the universe to help other organisms, or as I want to be cremated, yeah.
Yeah, I want to be cremated too, but I want to go to heaven. I want to go see all my family and shit.
Some of us would want to go to heaven, but stuff doesn't make it true.
Yeah, it's a beautiful idea, but there's not a shred of evidence that it actually happens.
But look, wouldn't you rather like see your family and all your members that have died previously and like...
Yeah, but what does what we would rather have happen have to do with anything?
Yeah, we don't determine the future events.
Yeah, we don't create heaven by believing in it. It either exists or it doesn't. No reason to believe that it does.
I mean, as an example, I want $1 million right now. I want a suitcase in front of me with $1 million.
Well, that's
wouldn't you rather
subject,
have $1 million?
Man. That's off the subject. You ain't even making
no, it's not. It's anything you want. All.
You want $1 million and dying is two different things.
Sure.
Okay.
But they're both cases of, you know, does believing it make it so? Well, no, it doesn't. And the time to believe that there is life after death is when there is evidence that there's life after death. No matter how appealing the idea is.
And life is bearable without hopes of an afterlife. I gave it up years ago, and I've been fine with it.
Yeah. If you want to live, if you want to keep living, put all of your extra money to support scientific medical research into life extension.
Hell no, that's going to my kids.
Okay. Well, okay. Thanks for your call.
Bye.
Like Walt Disney, he is frozen.
What line was I on? I was on...
You were on...
Everything's lit up here. It's really hard to tell.
The one that's not beeping, probably. Yeah, one's...
Okay. There we go. Let's go to... Ernie?
Hi.
Hi.
I wanted to commend you guys on putting up with all the weirdos this morning. You've done a real good job of not losing it over some of the things people have been saying on there. I have a kind of a practical question. I've been watching y'all for a long time, and I find myself every day just the things I say, like in sort of a casual conversation and just things you say to people, using sort of religionist type terms, things like bless you when somebody sneezes. And it seems kind of rude not to say anything, but I wanted to find out if there's some kind of a guide, or maybe you guys have some ideas about things like that you can kind of...
I have fun with that. I mean, I like coming up with my own things. If someone sneezes, I'll say, are you okay? You know? Yeah, just say something like that. Acknowledge it. We're used to hearing something, but it doesn't have to be something religious.
Yeah, it seems kind of rude not to say anything, but it's kind of... it seems kind of pretentious to say, you know, foreign words like, you know, salute or Gesundheit or something like that.
But you know what I love to say? If somebody sneezes, they'll go, achoo, and I'll go, shut up!
Or my friend, if you say bless you, he'll turn to you and say, like you care!
Yeah, there's no, like, manual of rules on what you can say.
Yeah, well, I know, it's not really a manual, but I thought maybe there might be some book that you guys have come across that might suggest things like that. My wife was a communications major in college, and she has a book called Elements of Non-Sexist Usage, and I thought maybe there might be, like, elements of non-religionist usage for tips on how to, you know, sort of purge the exclamations like, Jesus Christ, when somebody pulls in front of you in traffic and stuff like that, or,
right.
You know.
Right.
It's just habit, you know, and I know it's just, right. You can break habits, but...
It's all through the language, so, you know, that's the language we live with. You know, me personally, I try not to say those things
if you know, and if I can develop that habit, great. But if I don't, I'm not going to kick myself for it.
Yeah, I don't really kick myself, but I thought it might be kind of interesting to see if there was exercises like that that could be.
It's a good idea, but I don't recall ever seeing a book on that.
Yeah. Oh well.
And if there was a book, it'd just be suggestions. It would
yeah,
be
well,
only
sure.
A dog not a fall.
Yeah, I know. Okay, well, thanks. You guys have a great show.
Thanks a lot.
Appreciate it.
If I mention a suggestion from our producer Keith, he told me a very excellent thing. You know, when they give prayers at a dinner table. And, you know, you may feel like you're not really participating. Sometimes you don't even really want to put your head down and bow. And, well, afterwards, just grab your cup, lift it up, and say homage to the chef. And that's a suggestion from our producer, Keith.
Oh, yeah, that's good.
That's very nice.
Yeah, great.
I like that. All right, thanks for your call. Great.
Thank you.
Robert.
Yes.
Hi, dude.
How you doing today?
Good. How are you?
I would also like to agree with the last caller that y'all are doing a great job of putting up with the Looney Tunes calling in.
I don't know what it was this morning.
And, I would.
I do know what it was. It's called punctuated equilibrium, but okay.
And I would like to thank y'all for helping me clarify a lot of what I had difficulty with in beliefs. A long time ago, I wrote my life's motto, which I've shared on the show one time, which was, I don't believe in any race, tribe, religion, or creed. I only believe in you and your human need. But for years past that, I struggled with trying to come to grips with the idea of God that was being forced down my throat by all these people. And while I give people the respect of not trying to convert them into my way of being, that doesn't always come back. And what I like about your show is it's an open dialogue, and you're willing to at least listen to their point of view and refute it with words, and you don't necessarily attack their opinions or anything like that. And I just wanted to thank y'all for providing what I consider a positive environment to clarify thoughts, to clarify what we believe in.
Well, thanks. We appreciate it.
Thanks.
All right.
Y'all have a great one.
You too.
What?
And Joe?
How's it going there?
Good. How are you?
Pretty good. Hey, listen, I just had a question as far as what do you guys believe as far as how you came into existence or how we evolved?
Well, I mean, we're not going to be able to describe the entire evolutionary process to you in the space of a phone call. There are all kinds of great books on the subject.
So, I mean, but basically you don't believe that you were created by God.
Right. We'd have to believe in a God first for us to believe that.
Right.
That's two stretches.
So basically, your belief as far as evolution is scientific, from what you...
Sure. Is there a non-scientific belief in evolution?
Okay, so let me ask you this. Do you think it's easier to believe that the evolution process, okay, came about... I mean, there had to be a chain of events, which seems... there's so many change events that had to occur, than to just simply believe that there was a creator?
Well,
that's a separate issue also. Evolution, biological evolution, doesn't necessarily focus on how things started, but the process by which they're changing now.
Right.
Somewhere. Okay.
Right. Science,
yeah, but what I'm trying to say is...
working on the question of how the initial life forms came into existence. They're still working on that.
My point is... there had to be something present in order for these chain of events to happen. What I believe is that you can't get something from nothing. You need something there.
So I guess there's not a God. God would have to come from somewhere. Right?
Yeah.
That's the only violation that's allowed to.
The thing is, I mean, life.
I mean, how do you
life
explain?
Didn't come
how do you
from
explain?
Nothing,
first
right?
of all, how these all these things necessary. For us to come to existence, got here in the first place.
Yeah, but see, you could point to any dust particle anywhere on the Earth, right? And if you trace that dust particle's history, you'd find that it was acted on by all kinds of things that pushed it around and knocked it loose and carried it from here to there. And all those things had to happen exactly that way for that dust particle to wind up where it is. Well, that's not a miracle. That's just complicated.
Yeah, but we're rational human beings. Let me ask you, what do you think the purpose of our life here is? I mean, do you think that you have a purpose here in life as opposed to a dust particle?
Humans make their own purpose in life. If you want to have a purpose in life, design one for yourself. It's up to you. Everybody can do that. Or if you don't want one, you don't have to have one. Atheists have a very, very upstanding life. They can live and be just like other human beings and have a very positive, healthy mental outlook on life without a religion.
Yeah, I respect, you know, what you think. I just, in my opinion, it seems to be, I mean, you talk a lot about rationality, right, mm-hmm. as far as, you know, what you guys believe in.
Right.
But simply, it just seems a little bit less rational to believe that all these changing events happen and that then just to simply say, hey, you know, somebody had to create this universe.
Sure, I mean, making up a somebody to do the creating is not rational. That's the problem. See?
Yeah, I personally
do not. Complicated. Now, hang on. Evolution is complicated.
Right.
Right? I agree with you there. But it explains what we see in terms of stuff we actually can prove exists. Whereas God, simple as that explanation is, explains things in terms of something that we have no evidence for.
It's conjecture.
You can't just make up a God so that you have an easy explanation. That doesn't make
sense. No. I personally do not know in what form God is, okay? And none of us do, okay?
Well, but do you claim to personally know that God is?
No, that's what I'm trying to tell you.
Okay. Just check.
I personally do not know who it is that, or how it is that we got here, okay? And
uh-huh.
who it is that put these chain events, okay?
Right.
But it's easier for me to believe that this whole universe, okay, as miraculous as it can be, did not just came by coincidence. Okay.
Okay.
But
that doesn't. I mean, that doesn't answer any questions. It doesn't solve anything. All it does is it stops you from wondering about it.
No, I'm just saying it's easier for me to believe from a rational standpoint.
I'm not disputing that. I'm sure it is easier for you to believe that. What does that have to do with anything?
Does that make it true? I'm just asking you how. I mean, you claim to be so rational,
yep.
yet, you know, like I said, it's easier. I don't understand how you guys can say that something came from nothing.
What's really amusing to me about that particular point is I read this book called An Anthology of Atheism and Rationalism, and it was a collection of essays written by British freethinkers at the end of the 19th century, when these were guys who were trying to get the blasphemy laws in England overturned so that they could say in public that they didn't believe in God without being thrown in prison. And one of the interesting essays was a scientist of the time saying, well, you know, God, it doesn't make any sense for God to have created the earth because something can't come from nothing. Atheists at that time, before we had discovered evidence that there was the Big Bang, they were saying, well, something can't come from nothing, and God is a thing that makes stuff come from nothing. So it makes no sense. Right?
Yeah, it's beyond probably our way of thinking, okay? Maybe we are just not mentally, we don't have the capacity to mentally understand it.
Well, we're certainly not if the way we try to answer questions is we just try to come up with the easiest thing that we can convince ourselves with, and then that must be true.
Yeah, it's better to be patient and mm-hmm. wait for accuracy.
Yeah, you're just guaranteeing yourself that you're not going to be capable of understanding it then.
No.
If you're just making up a God so that you can have an easy answer for why all this stuff happened.
Well, I mean, we're talking about rationalism here, okay? I'm just saying...
Yeah, but rationalism doesn't allow you... I mean, real rationalism doesn't allow you to make up explanations out of nothing.
No, I'm not trying to explain the whole process. I'm just saying that it's...
You're not explaining any part of the process.
Well, let me just say it. I'm not trying to explain...
of a God whose existence you can't prove.
You're right. I can't prove it, okay?
So what difference does it make? Who cares what is easier to believe if the evidence points at something else?
Okay, well, we could argue about this all day, but you know, obviously you have your points. You're expressing your viewpoints,
yeah.
And I think the purpose of you having this, you know, allowing people to call is so that they can express their viewpoints.
Well, you did.
And all I'm saying is, from my perspective, it's easier to believe that there's a creator that created this universe and that we just didn't come here by chance.
Yeah, none of us are denying that it's easier for you to believe that.
That's
what
my
opinion.
What
we're saying is that doesn't make any sense.
Yeah. Okay, have a good day.
Thanks for calling.
Bye.
Yeah, belief is easy. Knowledge takes work.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
It takes a lot of guts to say you don't know. Mm-hmm. But then adding unnecessary variables like God doesn't make anything any clearer.
Yeah. And saying that a God created the universe is stacking conjecture on top of conjecture.
Right. Life didn't come from nothing, by the way. There were natural forces and matter in existence prior to to life arising on the Earth. So, I mean, that's not even an issue as far as the origin of life is concerned. If you want to get back to the Big Bang, physics is working on that too. But whatever is the explanation for why there's a universe here at all,
the only rational way to address that is in terms of stuff that we can actually show is true.
Hey, guys.
Hello?
Hey, this is Amanda.
Hi,
I'm
Amanda.
I'm in the control room here. Hey. Arlo's on the screen. Hi, Arlo.
Hello.
Hey, Joe.
Hi.
Oh, good, you can hear me. I just wanted to say, this is what we get together to do at the Atheist Community of Austin meetings at the Bagel Shop. We talk about ethics. We talk about human rights. We talk about what are we going to do 2 weeks from now for the heck of it to have fun with each other, because we like to get together with families. We like to get together with each other.
Yeah.
And, yeah, we do have a lot of negativity on the show, but that's not what we do together. We're not like this when we sit around munching our breakfast.
I'm even willing to argue that you know, just because we say, we point at a thing and we say that doesn't make any kind of sense and that's just wrong, right? You know, calling that negativity as if that was a reason not to say it, I don't get that, right? If an idea is wrong, somebody has to speak up and say, gosh, that just doesn't make any sense. People should stop believing that.
Well, that's okay. Why we have education. I don't think that we're on this show to tell people how science happens. That's what scientists right. do, and from that we get public education.
Yeah, well, so far. But that is under heavy attack. Let's go on to Michelle. Michelle?
Hi.
Hi, what can we do for you?
Well, I wanted to say that I thoroughly support what it is that you're out here talking about, and I personally am a recovering Catholic. I'll be fine in just a few more years, so they say. But I've had problems from, you know, early upbringing in Catholicism with, you know, they said that God was, you know, God created the earth in 7 days, and my big question had always been, well, you know, if God has always been there, then where did that come from? And they could never give me a good explanation for that, and eventually they asked my parents not to bring me back to religious education, which, you know, was real fun. But going back a few callers, the person who was asking about where you go when you die,
yeah,
I know in Catholicism they, on Ash Wednesday and all that, they do that whole ashes to ashes, dust to dust, and that's pretty much what I believe, is that you right. go back to where you came from, sure. which is the very dust that created the universe. And yeah. I find that within the religious community, they'll say those things, but it doesn't mean what they say it does.
Right. Yeah, they say that, but they're just talking about the physical body, right? Most people, when they ask that question of atheists, they're talking about a soul, right? They think that you've got some kind of supernatural, intangible, magical thing that animates your body, and that gets to go somewhere when your physical body turns back to dust. But there's no evidence that there is any such thing as a soul. So that's
a
problem.
And as far as discussion of rationality, how can you use a discussion of rational process and rational thought and then throw mysticism into it?
Yeah. I don't know.
Like I say, it's just conjecture, and to try to get scientific about something you can't ever bring into the lab is that's a worthless cause, I think.
Yeah, you got to be careful. When people claim that what they're doing is they're being rational, a lot of times what they're really doing is they're rationalizing, which is not the same thing.
Well, that's kind of my point, is that yeah. you can't have a rational thought and then throw in mysticism and throw in conjecture and I just think it's interesting that so many people would call up and accuse y'all, because you're the one sitting there, of not believing. You know, how can you go forth and not believe when in reality there's so many other ways of thinking about things.
Yeah. Well, thanks for your call.
Sure.
And she opened up the call with the question, what was God doing before he created the universe? And it's hard to get an answer, but there's actually a famous answer from a bishop who said he was creating a hell for people who ask such questions.
Right.
Oh, that's very amusing.
There's a discussion going on the Alt-Atheism news group, and my friend Dennis is active there. And the question of whether man can have free will if there is an omnipotent, omniscient God that created us has been batted around for months, and, you know... Mm-hmm.
the Christians generally retreating to the claim that, well, God exists in some kind of other dimension where he can see what's going on without it interfering with free will. And I won't get into that argument right now, but it's recently the argument has changed into whether God could have free will, right? How can a being that is omniscient and knows absolutely everything that's ever going to happen have a free will? He already knows exactly what he will always do. Well, where did those decisions come from? Is there some kind of uber God that decided what that God was going to do? Did they, like, wrote the entire script for eternity? It doesn't make any kind of sense. Let's go to John.
Yeah, you make an interesting point there. Wabba wabba, me one zella.
Right.
What faith do you prescribe to?
And who's next?
Callers,
well, Brian is next. Brian?
Turn the TV down.
You there?
Yeah.
Hi.
I was wondering, what is y'all's view on the creation of the universe? Like, do y'all believe in the Big Bang?
That is the prevalent theory in science right now. That's the theory that fits all of the observed evidence that we've got the best.
Well, what led you to that belief? I mean, didn't the Big Bang come from, like, one little atom? Who created that atom?
Well, what led me to that belief is I understand how science works, and I understand that in order to have a justified belief in something, it's got to be based on some evidence. And so that's what led me to my current position regarding evolution. So now you can ask me these separate questions about evolution. Go ahead and do that.
Well, I have a question, another question.
Okay.
What, did y'all, like, originally believe in God and then became atheists, or
anybody here?
Is there an event in your life that changed your beliefs?
I was raised Catholic.
I had sort of an agnostic's view on God. I never really expected to know any details, but science sort of kicked that out for me.
I was raised Methodist.
Well, was there, like, an experience in your life that just, like, screwed your whole belief in God?
Education for me. Science class. Physical science in 7th grade.
Well,
it was very slow for me. I think for most atheists, it's not an instant. Because for believers, they say, you know, it's some miracle. And there you go.
Yeah, I mean, you'll encounter people who will say that, well, you know, my child died, and how could God let that happen, and so that's why I decided to stop believing. Those people are actually very rare. You know, the number of people who have something that terrible happen to them, that one event can jog them out of years of indoctrination in religion, are really very rare. Most of us just thought about this stuff and learned things and finally came to the realization that this can't possibly make any sense.
And another thing, when they were talking about what happens when you die,
yeah,
do you, like, go into a state of nirvana where there's absolutely nothingness?
What part of us could go there? Our molecules are physical and they decompose.
Okay, so you then just, what? Like, die. Well, what gave you your life?
What gave me my life? Why are you even asking that? How do you know that there's a thing that could have given me what you call life?
I would say my parents.
Yeah.
Well, that's the way I'm interpreting the question.
Yeah, that is kind of a narrow question. What can you expand?
I mean, what gives a dog a life? What gives a slime mold a life?
Very good.
Well,
point.
Natural law.
It's all very natural. And it's a good thing that people die and that's it with their lives, because if they went on, like if there were souls, we'd be up to our ears in souls. If people, yeah, you wouldn't be able to move.
Hey, you know, but as soon as you invoke supernatural stuff, I mean, you can, the sky's the limit. Heaven could be this infinitely huge place where there's room for as many souls as you could possibly imagine. But it makes no sense to start going down that path. Do you have any other questions?
No, that's it. Praise the Lord.
All righty.
And pass the ammo.
Sorry.
Donette?
Hi.
Hi.
It's good to see you guys on here this morning. I've been living in Austin for 4 years. I'm atheist. I have a lot of friends who are atheists, and I've never even heard of your organization.
Really? Huh. Well, we're the Atheist Community of Austin. We meet every Sunday morning at the Hot Jumbo Bagel Shop at the corner of 5th and Lavaca.
That's great.
Starting right after the show. Come on down. There's a whole bunch of us, and you'll have a good old time.
I might do that. What I'd like to say, though, is it amazes me. It's kind of funny when you sit back, and not just from being an atheist. I think if you were just atheist-friendly or even just a neutral-type person, to sit back and listen to the callers that you have, because the ones that call and actually have an intelligent thing to say are the ones who are atheists. It just sounds so illogical irrational to believe in, like the one guy was talking about. well, where do you think you're going? And there has to, you can't believe that something just came upon this earth without any kind of like a spirit god of some sort or some kind of creation. But it amazes me to think, well, yeah, you know, everything is complicated. People are born, they die. We do have a complicated situation here, but it gets ridiculous when you start believing that something higher than that, something that you claim might have created all of that,
right,
just popped into this. When you could go on and on and on with this infinite tradition and this infinite magical belief, and what you really should do is look around you. I think those people have a hard time appreciating life for what it really is, because when you sit down and you look at things from a logical point of view, from a scientific point of view, then you can see, you can look at the beauty of that complication instead of just trying to make up some excuse for it or some kind of pop-out answer. Yeah. I like to commend you guys for getting up there and talking to these folks. I don't know how you do it. You guys have really good patience, and I don't know if I could be so patient up there. So I commend you, and you know, keep up the good work, guys. And yeah, I might end up down there. I didn't even know this. I hardly wake up this early on Sunday.
It's every Sunday except the first Sunday of each month. We have a lecture series at Furs Cafeteria at North Cross Mall.
Great. 11. You guys keep up the good work, man. It's great to see you up there, and you have some really good viewpoints. And man, you know, I'm thinking somebody must have put an atheist block on your line, because I've been trying to get in way early when those guys were ridiculing and saying all kinds of weird junk.
Yeah, well, the lines have been flooded since early during the show, and yeah, right. There hasn't been a lot of really good calls, but they've been awfully busy.
Right. Well, thanks a lot, guys.
Yeah, thanks for your call.
Uh-huh.
Thanks.
Whew, we have Amanda on one.
Hi.
Hi.
Hi, it's me again. I want to ask one more question.
Okay.
I'm wondering, how do you justify unadult or unacceptable behavior within yourself? Let's say you do something to somebody inadvertently, or lie, cheat, steal, you know, something that nobody else knows, just you. How do you justify yourself? We call it sins. What do you call it?
Stupidity.
Stupidity.
Personally,
and
I haven't been doing that in the past 5 years.
But who do you
about.
Apologize to? Who do you ask for forgiveness? How do you do this?
I know. I worry about self-improvement.
Self-improvement. Good.
Well, I try not to screw up in the first place, because I don't want to be put in that situation.
Yeah. All that stuff that people call sin. I mean, there are things that religious people call sins that are actually activities that are bad. Right, but when I say bad, I don't mean because some god said that's bad. I mean bad because look what happens when people act that way, right? Oh. And for those things, you know, the reason not to do them is because it's short-sighted and foolish to act in ways that are just going to cause trouble for you and everybody else.
Unadult or unacceptable. But,
right.
Like, the way I ask God to forgive me for something that, you know, that I wish I would have been able to tell that person to their face, you know what, I'm sorry I did that to you.
Mm-hmm.
I ask God to forgive me for my sins so that I don't, if I can go on, you know, and do something, I'm going to do more sins. I'm not perfect. I'm always going to do something bad, you know.
Okay.
We're not perfect people.
We know
and
that.
We have bad thoughts, or I'll see somebody walking down the street, they look ugly to me, I'll say, geez, what an ugly guy, you know. But that's, to me, in my mind, I don't see.
You're drawing Jesus' attention to that guy, too.
So, you know, and I'm wondering, how do you guys justify it for yourself, to make you feel better? About yourself, whatever bad that you did, you know, how do you forgive yourself? How do you... Is that just it? You forgive yourself. You have that power to do that.
Yeah, it's no great mystery.
Like most people, we try to right the wrong if possible, if it's something like that. But atheists have ethics. And
can we get camera 2, please?
Yeah. I'm constantly asked by Christians, where do you get your morals or your ethics?
Morals,
and,
yeah, I like that word.
And I say basically the same place you did. Mom and dad, family, friends, teachers, police, fire department, all kinds of exposure you have as growing up. But certainly not a god, because obviously a god really doesn't interfere with people's lives at all. And so basically we get them from the same place that religious people do.
Do your parents feel the same way you feel now today? All of your parents? I know you, Joe, you were brought up as a Catholic.
My mom's Methodist now, and she's very strong.
Yeah, we all have our own gods. What about you?
My parents are both ministers.
Really?
Used to be Methodist, now they're non-denominational.
That is so interesting. And you, sir, with the glasses?
For me, when I was raised, religion was never really brought up. I guess I'd say I was raised in a secular household. And now that I talk about these things, I have a great interest in religion, and my parents are very supportive of my atheism, but they are not atheists. I would consider them agnostics.
Yeah. Less people think that being raised by ministers is what made me an atheist. They didn't become ministers until after I was grown up and out of school and living on my own.
Actually, I need to take something back, though, because I realize when I say my parents, I mean I was raised by my mother and my grandmother, and that's what I'm talking about. They're more of an agnostic. They have a personal God, but they don't push it. But my father, the reason I didn't mention him is I didn't meet him until recently. He's a devout Muslim, but he's also an astronomer, and it's very interesting, his views on things, but I have a lot to learn about that. So.
Okay, well, thank you. We had a very positive conversation.
Thank you.
Take care.
Bye-bye. Barry?
Yes.
Hi.
Good morning, gentlemen.
Hi.
You've had your fair share of idiots and hypocrites this morning. Joe, it's good to see you again.
Hey.
Yeah, I've been watching this show a long time. I had an experience as a former police officer. It amazed me, especially I think Jeff would probably appreciate this more than anyone else. As a former police officer, the first arrest or so-called arrest that I happened to go on was a domestic dispute. And situation being as it was, the husband beat up the wife, and he was a minister. And because of the religious hypocrisy, he managed to not get arrested.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
In Texas? How did that work exactly? Did you just say, you know, hey, I'm a minister, guys, look the other way, or what happened?
Well, basically, what happened was is he broke up the house in front of his children. That was kind of amazing. Slammed his wife around a little bit. And I don't know if you're familiar with the procedures of police officers, but as one of the two first police officers arriving, the way you handle it is one officer takes the alleged victim and the other officer goes off and interviews the other person. Mm-hmm. And I got to interview the man. Mm-hmm. And in the interview, I found out he was a minister. Well, because of this, he was actually a lower minister in a large church here in Austin, actually in Williamson County. And he got our shift commander notified the head pastor of the church. The head pastor said, well, would you cut this minister a little bit of a break and I'll take charge and see to it that this never happens. Now, that was a blatant violation of the law.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Under the Texas Penal Code, you go on a domestic dispute, someone goes to jail.
Yes.
I don't believe it's that way any longer. I haven't been a police officer for a few years.
I bet it is.
In any event, I found that to be, that was my first alleged supposed arrest. And I guess the point of the whole story is religious hypocrisy.
Yeah.
What's good for all of these callers who are calling you and slamming you and telling you how bad you are, what's good for them is not, they can break their rules, they can do as they choose, they're Catholic, Southern Baptist, whatever they may be, Jews, it doesn't matter, but yet they know, I know, you know, this type of thing happens every day, and yet people can call you up and give you a rash and call you all kinds of bad names and call you and give you all that crap that you've been getting all that you've gotten so far this morning, which I've found not hilarious, but I watch your show every Sunday. I could go to church. I could go any place I want. I prefer to sit and watch you because I think you fellas are outstanding. You are very, very tolerant, and I admire you all. By the way, where's Ray?
Ray is on the other side of the camera today.
Oh, well, hello, Ray. I do watch you every Sunday. I'll continue to watch you
Okay.
Until I either move or die. And I guess I don't know where I'm going to be when I move or die, but I'll continue to watch you. I think you got a great show. And
can I ask you, sir, are you an atheist?
No, I'm not. Okay. I'm probably an agnostic.
All right. Well, that's close enough. Come on down to the bagel shop.
You know, one of these days, I want to, and I definitely intend to. I want to meet you fellas and talk to you one-on-one, and I'm not a converter.
Okay.
I'm more interested in just conversing. Mm-hmm. I'd like to talk and hear what you have to say.
Meetings are open to anybody who's atheist friendly.
Well, I'm not. Right. I'm not. I'm very atheist friendly. I'm very people friendly, and I like people in general. And I like you guys. And I think you guys are doing a wonderful job. And you're very tolerant. And have yourself a good day.
Yeah, I just wanted to let you know I was here. Thank you for saying hello to Ray there. So
yeah, I missed you, Ray. I'm kind of like you. I'm follically challenged. I don't like the word bald. I find that very offensive. But I think follically challenged is more politically correct. And I can relate to you there. But I did miss you, and I was wondering where you are.
Well, thank you. Yes, I'm going to be moving behind the camera here on a regular basis. I'm going to finish out the year. And in January, I'll be moving behind the camera.
Really?
Yes.
Who's going to be in the host, Jeff?
I get to move up to the host slot. And
Jeff,
have you seen Vic on the show, Vic Farrell?
Is he the heavyset fella?
No.
No.
He is the sandy-haired, dashing young
fellow. Well, we get Vic
the dashing
fellow,
okay.
Hey, Vic,
yes,
right
I believe I have.
We'll get, Vic's been Vic has actually been doing the call screeners today. And I invited him out on camera there just so you'd meet him.
Come on, Vic.
Is he coming out?
He'll get your fill of him next year.
Okay. Yeah, well, I'll get back to the control booth. Great job, guys.
All right. Thanks for your call.
Well, thank you. And I do plan on coming down and seeing you guys one of these days.
Cool. That'd be wonderful.
Okay. You
Bye-bye.
Take it. Have a good day, sir.
Bye
bye.
Before we go off, I want.
Go ahead. Oh, my gosh.
There.
You took one out. They're little.
Yeah. These are great. I just got to show these. Can we zoom the camera in?
Go to one and zoom in on
yeah.
one. Go to one.
Oh, there. Well, we got.
Oh, there we go.
There we go. These are so great. Testaments. Zurda Krishna stories. Little mints right there. Little crosses. I just love these. I had to show them. I'm very proud of them. I collect them all. And these are great. And if you put them in your mouth upside down, they burn. Or maybe that's just because I'm atheist. Those are great. Anyway, my little review.
Christian candies.
Breath mint review.
Where are we at? Anybody else got anything else? Or should we keep going with calls?
Go ahead. I'll look for some.
Let's do more calls. Bob?
Yes, hello.
Hi, Bob.
Hi, hello. How are y'all?
Good. How are you?
Pretty good. Are y'all enjoying your Sunday so far?
Yeah, sure.
Great. So I just got one question for y'all, and then I'll hang up and let you answer it.
Okay.
Now, the evolution versus creation.
Mm-hmm.
I know y'all believe in evolution, so think about this. Those tables, or that table you're sitting at, those chairs you're sitting on, that building you're in.
Yeah.
If I came up to you and I said, hey, those objects just kind of formed and appeared, you'd think I was nuts, right?
Yeah.
So, with creation, being that we're much more complex, human being-wise, more
right.
perfect, wouldn't you think that something created us as well? And that's all I basically got to say.
Okay.
Yeah. All right, bye.
And I'll answer that. My first question, when you say that chairs look created, right? My first question would be, in comparison to what? And ultimately, you would have to say, well, in comparison to, say, you know, the grass and trees and rocks and dunes and stars and planets and stuff outside. And the point of this is that these look created compared to the universe. And if your argument is that the universe, well, its complexity must have been created, comparing it to a chair fails to make your case. It proves that the universe looks not created in comparison to the things that we know certainly were.
Well, and also a chair is not an organic organism, a living organism. I'm constantly hearing that kind of analogy again and again with things that don't live. And I have to remind people who come up with that biological evolution doesn't really address inanimate objects. There's a big difference, and anyway.
Right, I mean, difference is there is a process that leads up to this creation, and we can see small amounts of it as observable. And there you go.
Can
That's
I real quick
also comes in.
Several people like to pick at the Promise Keepers, and the American Atheist has been at most of their conferences this year, and this was the one in New Jersey recently. Hard to see, I know it's very small, but
We had a little area that was marked off, or a bunch of barricaded off, a little area there that the police had for us, and we were literally surrounded by thousands of Promise Keepers, men and boys, and we wanted to keep it a real positive picket, and all basically it was them learning about us and atheists, and a really good opportunity to let them know our views in a positive way. And they actually went back. This was at New Jersey in the Meadowlands complex, at the Continental Airlines Arena, and they had something like 18,000 Promise Keepers there. And we're told that right after the picket that we had, they all went back inside and, of course, had a big out loud prayer for the atheists out in the parking lot, you know. And it was, but it was very interesting. They learned about us and we learned about them, and they are still having their conferences. They don't attract as many people to these things, and they're not doing as well financially as they were in 97. But I think they've softened up the submission message a little bit, so. Maybe we're doing some good, I don't know.
And maybe they learned some lessons from that. There's some news articles about Promise Keepers going to strip clubs right after the rallies.
Right, and there were other groups involved there too. This was a multi-organizational thing. There was some people there from the National Organization for Women. There was a couple of witches there. Mm-hmm. And there was a female minister who was part of an interfaith coalition who was there picketing with us.
Oh.
So, could it possibly be these guys? This is something I got in the mail recently. That got brought up. I've got this pamphlet in the mail. You don't have to zoom in on it. But it's a group called the Interfaith Alliance. And basically, it's liberal and moderate Christians getting together to combat the intolerances of the religious right. And I'm really glad to finally see some evidence of religious people cleaning their own house. You know, being willing to turn a critical gaze on other people who believe roughly the same thing, but with different particulars that are more dangerous. But my reaction to this overall is, why make a group to combat the religious right that you have to be a that has to be faith-based? You know, these guys don't want atheists to be part of their opposition to the religious right. And there are already organizations that are doing this that are not that are non-sectarian, like the Americans United for the Separation of Church and State. So I'm glad to see Christians finally liberal Christians finally standing up against religious intolerance, but I'm not sure it's the most efficient thing they could have done.
Hey, on that note, can I just say the Religious Liberty Protection Act also is back in Congress?
Yeah.
It was going to go on the floor for a vote in the Senate a couple weeks ago, but that got sidetracked because of the budget fight, and then recesses are coming up. But this is always going to be tossed around in Congress for years to come in many different versions, and essentially what it does is it neuters the First Amendment. The Establishment Clause is basically stopped by it, and as an atheist, I feel it's not necessary because the First Amendment already guarantees enough religious liberty in our country. We have plenty of that.
It's been plenty religious liberty for them until now.
Mm.
Why all of a sudden now do they have to attack the Constitution?
Oh, well.
Probably because it's the millennium and they're all getting crazy. Let's take another call. John?
Hey.
Hi.
You all believe in reason and science so much. Why do you meet in a bagel shop? Why don't you meet in a science laboratory or something?
Good question. The bagels are better at the bagel shop than in the science lab.
We're not scientists.
Yeah. I didn't say that.
Well,
most museums are closed on Sundays.
What do you got against bagels?
Nothing. It's just...
Thanks for calling. And Nick?
Hey, how's it going?
Hi, Nick.
Good.
How are you?
Just quick question, well, actually a comment. I'm Christian for one, and I just commend you guys for standing up for what you believe in.
I don't believe in.
Well, not as far as your belief or, you know, what you believe is what you feel is real.
Yeah.
If you believe that there is no God or anything, what is the higher power? How do you feel that you were created? Or?
What do you mean, what is the higher power?
Well, for me, I believe that Jesus is the higher power.
Yeah, why do you assume that we need to believe in a higher power to make any kind of sense?
But 1 minute.
How were you created?
Well, we don't think we were. We think we are the product of natural processes working on matter.
Yeah, we've gone over this too. We have 45 seconds.
Yeah,
you might.
Call again next show and we can get into this more deeply. We're out of time.
Out of time.
Bye-bye.
No problem.
Sorry.
We don't mean to cut you off, but we're down to 30 seconds. So, thanks everybody for watching. all you atheists and atheist-friendly people, come meet us at the Hot Jumbo Bagelry, and I'm supposed to do the love thing. This is the atheist love going out there to the city of Austin. I'm sorry, it's out of control. Ah!
It's green.
Thanks for having me.
Thanks. Thanks for coming, Joe
Zemecki. Good to meet you. Yeah.
And good luck out there in New Jersey, and good luck to American atheists.
Yeah, let us know what's going on down there.
Right. Bye-bye, everybody.
Goodbye.